Good afternoon, everyone. I'll take full responsibility for the weather, so I apologize. I know it came down just as some of you were coming in here. But I'm the president of St. Catherine University, and it is my honor to welcome you to this and to be here to celebrate with all of you. We were just thrilled and so honored that Anne asked us to do this very special event in her life at her alma mater, which is this university. She is a true role model for all of our students, including me, because I was a student here too. Her passion, her drive for excellence, her commitment to justice is really a motivation and such a height to achieve for our other students here. Anne is also what we call a duplicate, and her mother, Cecilia Waddles McKeig, is also a Katie, and she will be doing the invocation today. Last May, Cecilia was presented with a Medal of Distinction at our commencement ceremonies. We love to tell the story that both Anne and her mother, Cecilia, were liberal arts graduates, dedicated their lives to serving others. Cecilia was an educator and then a historian, and Anne was a litigator bringing justice to those who don't have a strong voice in our system. My role before I was at St. Catherine University, I was at the YWCA Minneapolis, and I remember driving home in June when the governor, who will be out here soon, announced Anne's appointment. And for someone whose mission was the elimination of racism, the empowerment of women and girls, it does not get better than her announcement, and I listened to it all the way home. Told my husband about it. The next morning I woke up, went out, Mark was reading, he said, sit down, it gets even better. And I said, what could be better? And he said, she's a Katie. And I had already accepted the role at St. Catherine, so all day long, everyone I saw, I said, do you know who the next Supreme Court Justice is? She is a Katie. No surprise, she's a Katie. Both these Katies, Anne and her mother Cecilia, are examples that prove a liberal arts education is relevant. And when the going gets tough, the liberal arts help you think your way out of them. They are proof of what the Sisters of St. Joseph of Carondelet founded their order on in France in the 16th century. Their original charter was to give women all that they are capable of and which most benefit the dear neighbor. And so today we are all here to celebrate Anne, a capable woman and certainly a dear neighbor to us all. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to the swearing-in ceremony of Anne K. McKeig as the 94th Associate Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court. I am Rita Coyle-Demules, the Commissioner of the Minnesota Supreme Court, and I will be introducing our special guest today. Before we begin, please stand as the White Earth Honor Guard posts the colors.
Away, 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 away
It is now my honor to introduce the state elected officials who are with us today, as well as members of the tribal courts, the federal and state judiciaries, and those speaking on behalf of the appointee. With us today are the state constitutional officers, state auditor Rebecca Otto and attorney general Lori Swanson. Also with us are the judges of the courts of the tribal nations located within the state of Minnesota. It gives me great pleasure to present the judges. It gives me great pleasure to present the judges of the state of Minnesota. From the state judicial branch are the judges of the Minnesota Court of Appeals. And the Minnesota District Court judges. And the 4th Judicial District referees. From the executive branch, with us are the judges of the tax court, the judges of the Workers' Compensation Court of Appeals, and the judges of the Office of Administrative Hearings. Please welcome from the state judicial branch the members of the Minnesota Supreme Court. And finally, please welcome our special guests, Ms. Brittney Miller, Ms. Noya Woodrich, Mr. Philip Brodeen, the president of the Minnesota American Indian Bar Association, Ms. Robin Wolpert, the president of the Minnesota State Bar Association, and the governor of the state of Minnesota, the Honorable Mark Dayton. We will now be joined by Cecilia McKeig, mother of Justice Ann McKeig, who will give the invocation.
O Great Spirit, whose voice I hear in the winds and whose breath gives life to everyone, hear me. I come to you as one of your many children. I am weak. I am small. I need your wisdom and your strength. Let me walk in beauty and make my eyes ever behold the red and purple sunsets. Make my hands respect the things you have made. and make my ears sharp so I may hear your voice. Make me wise so that I may understand what you have taught my people and the lessons you have hidden in each leaf and each rock. I ask for wisdom and strength, not to be superior to my brothers, but to be able to fight my greatest enemy, myself. Make me ever ready to come before you with clean hands and a straight eye. So as life fades away as a fading sunset, my spirit may come to you without shame.
Thank you, Ms. McKeig. Now it is my honor to introduce the Chief Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court, Lori Gilday.
Please be seated. On behalf of the Minnesota Judicial Branch, I want to welcome all of you to the investiture of Anne Catherine McKeig as the 94th Associate Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court. I especially want to recognize Governor Mark Dayton, Attorney General Lori Swanson, State Auditor Rebecca Otto, and the many judges, tribal and state court judges, who have joined us today. And of course, we're honored to be joined today by the family, friends, and many well-wishers of Justice McKeig. As many of you know, we have had a few of these investiture ceremonies in the past year. Our court has undergone some significant changes, as we've seen some very experienced and valued members of the court move on to different chapters in their lives and careers. Amid these changes, we have been fortunate to see new justices of great capability and temperament appointed to our court, each bringing their own unique perspective and experience to our collaborative body. These ceremonies allow us to celebrate the incredible institution that is the Minnesota Supreme Court, and to reflect on how fortunate we are to have a judicial selection process in this state that ensures we have such capable and qualified individuals serving on our courts. Justice McKeig exemplifies this great Minnesota tradition. She brings to the court a remarkable depth of experience as a judge, prosecutor, and educator. Her passion for the law and her commitment to preserving the fairness, integrity, and accessibility of our courts is unquestioned. As you will hear today from the people who know her best, she is deeply respected and admired for her work and her dedication. Anne, I'm so grateful to be able to share this day with you, your family, and your friends. It is an honor to call you my colleague and my friend. On behalf of the entire judiciary, I want to thank you for everything you have given to public service so far and congratulate you as you begin serving in this new role. I now want to invite President Robin Wolpert to speak on behalf of the Minnesota State Bar Association.
I am so honored and delighted to be here on behalf of the State Bar and its 15,000 members to offer a warm and enthusiastic congratulations to Justice McKeig, the first Native American to serve on our Supreme Court, and perhaps the first Native person to hold statewide constitutional office in Minnesota's history. On behalf of the State Bar, I also offer congratulations to our Supreme Court, Governor Dayton, the members of our Commission on Judicial Selection, our judiciary, and members of the legal profession. That is because today's momentous occasion is part of a greater narrative regarding the diversification of the legal profession and the judiciary in Minnesota. Minnesota has led the nation in its effort to diversify its highest court. And this effort has been the result of a long-term partnership between the bench, the state bar, and our political leaders from both sides of the aisle. In 1991, for example, our court became the first in the nation to have a majority of women justices, and we achieve that status again today with the investiture of Justice McKeig. We have and have had two remarkable women chief justices, Justice Kathleen Blatz and our current Chief Justice Lori Gilde. And we have three extraordinary African American members of our court who are currently serving or have served in the past, Justice Alan Page, Justice Mimi Wright, and Justice Natalie Hudson. And of course, we have an exceptional justice, Justice Chudich, who is the first openly gay person to serve on our highest court. And now today, we have our first Native American. So to people outside the state of Minnesota, and to people inside the state of Minnesota, I say, look at this court. This is our court, and it speaks volumes to the legal profession and the public about the state of the rule of law in Minnesota. Our effort to break barriers and diversify our bench and bar has been a longstanding commitment of the Minnesota State Bar Association, and it is a continuing commitment. And here's why it's so important. Public trust and confidence in the judiciary is essential to the rule of law. If the bench does not reflect the society it serves, it creates the reality or the perception that justice is not the same for everyone. How many of you in the room, how many of you lawyers in the room, have had conversations with clients who have said, I have no chance in court, they will never believe me, they never understand me, and they don't like people like me? How many of you had those conversations? How many of you have taken the opportunity to help dispel those fears and perceptions? Every day, we lawyers have the opportunity to do that, to build trust and confidence in our judiciary. These perceptions hurt our profession, and they undermine the power of the judiciary. In Federalist 78, Alexander Hamilton said, "The judiciary, from the nature of its functions, will always be the least dangerous to the political rights of the Constitution because it will be least in a capacity to annoy or injure them. The judiciary has no influence over the sword or the purse, no direction either of the strength or of the wealth of the society, and can take no active resolution whatever. It may truly be said to have neither force nor will, but merely judgment, and must ultimately depend upon the aid of the executive arm, even for the efficacy of its judgments." Hamilton went on to say that the court had no implementation powers because the court can do no more than say something. The effect depends on others. So the judiciary's power and legitimacy comes from the support of the public and the other branches of government. This is why our commitment to the diversification of the bench and bar must be front and center for the future, because it maintains and promotes public trust and confidence in our courts, and that in turn shapes the nature and scope of judicial power. Demographers tell us that by 2050, we will be a majority-minority nation. Justice McKeig's appointment today is momentous precisely because it gives our judiciary the opportunity to expand its efforts to build trust and confidence with more constituencies, and for her personally to serve as a model for those in the legal profession who can only be inspired by her life story and tremendous accomplishments. So on behalf of the State Bar, I say, let's celebrate today and not forget the future we are building is a mountain with no top, with continuing obligations and opportunities for our lawyers to build support for the rule of law and trust and confidence in our great Minnesota judiciary. Thank you.
Thank you, President Wolpert. Next, I want to introduce Philip Brodeen, president of the Minnesota American Indian Bar Association, to say a few words.
Ujugiinawa, Phil Brodeen, Indigenous Cause Jagannashimong. Makwa Nindu Dame, Asabi Kone Zaga Eganing Nindunjaba. Aside from confusing our delightful sign language interpreter, I just introduced myself in my native tongue of Anishinaabe. It's an honor to be here today. Truly, I didn't know if this would happen during my tenure as president of the Minnesota American Indian Bar Association or my legal career. Although I'm young, this is quite the accomplishment for Judge McKeig and Indian country in general. So on behalf of the Minnesota American Indian Bar Association, I'd like to congratulate Judge McKeig. I've said before at a number of events that women are the backbones of Native American communities. Judge McKeig's career shows this to be true. Her dedication to service, justice, and providing a voice for the voiceless is truly inspirational. I hope that Judge McKeig's appointment today is not the end of the narrative, but instead the beginning of an era where our Native American leaders and qualified candidates are given a chance to make meaningful contributions to our society. I'd like to applaud Governor Dayton for his unprecedented commitment to judicial diversity. In closing, it's often said that what we do today will impact the next seven generations. I know this will undoubtedly hold true with Judge McKeig's appointment. Thank you.
Thank you, President Brodeen. Next, I have the great honor of introducing our current governor of the state of Minnesota, Mark Dayton. During his time in office, Governor Dayton has been a strong partner with Minnesota's court system, and he has shown unwavering respect for the judiciary as a separate and co-equal branch of government. We are particularly grateful to Governor Dayton's steadfast support for the judiciary's budget request, and we appreciate so much. You have a chance to do that again soon. Sorry. I can't ever miss an opportunity. We're also so very grateful for the care and diligence with which Governor Dayton carries out his constitutional obligation to fill judicial vacancies. Please join me in welcoming our friend, Governor Mark Dayton.
Regarding the budget, the Chief Justice and I have a very simple and straightforward procedure. We go together to a Minnesota Lynx playoff game. At halftime, she hands me a slip of paper with a number on it. And that's what I put faithfully into my budget request. For the official record, I'm not Kim Holmes, my excellent general counsel who's listed on your program. I was previously scheduled to be out of our state today, but I rearranged my schedule in part to take part in this historic investiture. After 40 years of driving all over Minnesota, I know most places. But I confess that until a few months ago, I had never heard of Federal Dam up near Leech Lake, which is where Judge McKeig was raised. To go from Federal Dam to St. Catherine University is just one of the remarkable leaps forward she's made in her life. I recall the story of another young girl who grew up in a small town in northern Minnesota, built an exceptional career, and now distinguishes herself as the Chief Justice of our Supreme Court. Chief Justice Gilday, there must be something special in the water in northern Minnesota, or else it's the early falls and the long winters. Much of the press about my appointment of Judge McKeig to serve on Minnesota Supreme Court is focused on what she is. It's true that this appointment is an historic first, and that it furthers my commitment to make Minnesota's government look more like the people of our state. However, I appointed Judge McKeig first and foremost because of who she is, not what she is. I wanted to appoint a person with impeccable professional credentials, high intelligence, great integrity, and a proven judicial temperament. I wanted someone who would work well with the six other excellent justices whom Governor Plenty and I have appointed to the Supreme Court. And after all, my appointee would take the place of a very distinguished jurist, Associate Justice Christopher Dietzen, to whom all Minnesotans owe our deep gratitude for his outstanding service to our state. Once again, the Judicial Selection Commission, led so extraordinarily well by Lee Sheehy, made my decision very difficult by recommending three outstanding candidates. Any one of them would be a superb Supreme Court Associate Justice. Justice McKeig, however, is very special. She was born into a life much like many of the people who become involved with Minnesota's court system: poverty, discrimination, seemingly too few opportunities. Yet she lifted herself above and beyond those disadvantages which have crippled others. She has been, from all accounts, an exceptional judge on the Hennepin County District Court. The court's chief judge wrote me, quote, "In her 8 years on the district court bench, Judge McKeig has established herself as one of the preeminent trial judges in the state of Minnesota, especially in the areas of juvenile and family law. She's known for her ability to handle a heavy caseload with grace, a sense of humor, and great analytical skill. There are few judges I know who exhibit the combination of professional demeanor, common sense, intelligence, trial skill, and respect for all persons that Judge McKeig demonstrates on a daily basis. The Hennepin County District Court is one of the government entities most engaged with the real-world lives of increasing numbers of Minnesotans. I trust that Justice McKeig will remember them, their struggles, and their hopes and opportunities as she sits on her state's highest court. I can fill the next several hours with all the accolades Judge McKeig received in support of her application. But I think she best summed up her special qualities in her own words in her letter of application. She wrote, I quote, "I believe that public service is the highest possible calling for an attorney. In my case, as a Native American who received the blessings of education and opportunity, the calling of public service is that much greater. From those to whom much is given, much is expected. As you will see from the materials I am submitting, I am deeply committed to remedying problems of the underrepresented and the underserved by applying my leadership skills and legal education with vigor and enthusiasm." Continuing the quote, "Supreme Court justices enjoy a privileged position through which they can influence the laws and policy of the state through carefully considered decisions applied to the actions of the legislature and the governor. I'm eager to apply the experiences, the insights, and the training I have received in the service of Minnesotans from every walk of life. Congratulations, Justice McKeig. I trust and believe you will fulfill that commitment." Thank you.
Thank you, Governor Dayton. Next, I'm going to introduce three speakers who have been chosen to provide remarks on behalf of Justice McKeig. First, we will hear from Brittney Miller. Brittney is an attorney at the Moss and Barnett firm working in the family law department. But before that, she clerked for then Judge Ann McKeig. Please welcome Brittney Miller.
Hello, it's an honor to be here. So you can tell a lot about a judge by the way she treats her clerks. The fact that Judge McKeig is trusting me with a microphone in front of all of you should clue you into what kind of judge she is, because I did work for her. I think there's a lot of trust there because, let's be honest, I know a lot. When you meet Judge McKeig, one of the first things you'll realize is that she's not one for formalities. In fact, she insists that her law clerks call her Ann. So if I accidentally do that while I'm up here, it's not disrespectful. It's just I've been scolded many times because I have accidentally called her Judge McKeig, and that's not okay, even in public. And before I started working for her, I was in the process of interviewing with her, which was a little nerve-wracking. She was the presiding judge of family court at the time, which was intimidating. But she also had this reputation of being a bit of a prankster in the courthouse. And there were rumors floating around that she had tinfoiled another judge's chambers, literally from floor to ceiling. And so I was wondering, well, if I get this job, am I going to be expected to participate in these pranks? And if so, how do you surpass tinfoiling a room? Well, the answer to the first question is yes, I was. And to the second question, fortunately, Judge McKeig has endless ideas for pranks. So it was really when I started working for her that I got a sense of who she is as a person and as a mentor and a judge. And I can tell you, in family law, if you've never had experience with it, it is complicated, challenging, and emotionally demanding. For a lot of people in the field, it's easy to be a little cynical and a little disengaged, but not Judge McKeig. She brings a sense of humor and just lightheartedness that is so desperately needed in this line of work. But more importantly, she treats her clerks, she treats the people who come before her as her equal, even though she's in a black robe. She is kind and thoughtful to everyone she encounters. As an example, as a boss, she would jump in any chance she could if we were feeling overwhelmed or things were getting a little hectic, and she would help us out. Sometimes this meant answering the chamber's phone herself, which she found entertaining, but I think terrified the attorneys on the other end of the line. And on the days we had the domestic abuse calendar, which is a very chaotic calendar, she took over all of the technology. She called up her own cases, ran the dreaded online chat room, and then she would literally run the orders to the fax machine to fax them to the people downstairs waiting for them. I didn't see any other judges running to the fax machine other than her. But I think one of the most memorable stories I have of working with her is not as funny as it is, a little sentimental, and she said I could get a little sentimental, so I'm going to. We had a parenting time hearing, and the parents who in the field of family law we say were very high conflict parents, and they brought their two young children with them to the hearing, which you don't usually do, and we frown upon. And before I could even ask Judge McKeig how we were going to handle the situation, she kicked me out of the courtroom with some highlighters and computer paper and told me to go into a conference room and color with the kids, which I did. But instead of calling for a backup clerk, she just handled the whole hearing by herself, went on the record, did it all. And just when I was running out of things to color with a yellow highlighter, because there are only so many options, she walked toward the door with the parties. So I'm thinking, okay, she's out of the courtroom, off the bench, what happened? And she explained later that she wanted to make sure, after giving them some co-parenting advice, that they followed that advice, and that this parenting time transition that was going to take place at the hearing, after the hearing, when mom would start her parenting time, went smoothly for the kids, and that the parents didn't start arguing again once they were outside of her courtroom. I just think this exemplifies who she is as a judge. She looks out for children, she looks out for people. That is where she places, that's her priority. And I think that that's why us in the family law community respect her so much. And it's also why people line up waiting to get her advice. And I'm not saying that figuratively, people actually lined up outside of her chambers to get her advice. And I know this better than anyone because my desk faced our door. And I would be interrupted multiple times a day by guardians, clerks, judges, you know who you are, who would come in and say, they all had the same question, and it was, is she in? And before I could get out a word or stop them if she was busy, they'd be booking it to her door, ready to ask her a question. And the reason people lined up is because, well, not only does she know a lot about family law, she's an expert, but also, I think more importantly, she knows the people we serve. She knows the struggles that they go through. She empathizes with them. And she doesn't believe that family court needs to be another burden or obstacle that they have to face, you know, if they end up finding themselves in her courtroom. She's there to make things easier. And we in that community know that. We know that she's the person you seek out if you have an idea about how to improve the way we do business, the way we serve our communities. And we go to her and we tell her because we know that she will lead the way toward change. So when I hear people in the legal community talk about access to justice in abstract terms, I think about Judge McKeig and I think about the kind of judge she was and how she lived it, how she lived her purpose. And that's why I'm so excited she's joining the Minnesota Supreme Court. I can't wait to see what she does. So thank you for being such a wonderful friend and mentor, and I'm sorry, Justice McKeig.
Thank you, Brittney. Next, we'll hear from Noya Woodrich. Noya has spent her career working on issues of health and education disparities for American Indians. She was president and CEO of the Greater Minneapolis Council of Churches from 2012 to 2016, and prior to that was with the Division of Indian Work from 1991 to 2012. Please help me welcome Noya Woodrich.
So time to get real. I was told I needed to be the funny one. So here I am, not up here talking about Anne from a professional perspective, but professional she is. Thank you, Governor Dayton, for choosing Anne to join the Minnesota Supreme Court. As an American Indian woman, I'm proud to call her friend and proud to see her take this role on. But Anne is so many other things. She's a mother, she's a daughter, she's a wife, and she's a friend. I'm going to speak a little bit on behalf of the group that we call the Posse. And that is the group of us that go to Mexico together every year. It consists of Ann, myself, Kelly, Debbie, and Jamie. It's interesting, I've known Ann since 1997, and I actually met her in Mexico. Never knew her before that, but we were going, I and a friend were going to Mexico, and she and a friend were going to Mexico, and we met down there in Mazatlan. I was there when she met her husband, Jose. I was there when she first met her future kids, Balam, Itzel, and Seiko. But there's some things that as a professional person, or people that know her from a professional aspect, don't know about her. For instance, did you know that she loves to sing? We will often find a karaoke place down in Mexico, and she sings a mean Winona Judd. Last year, she actually got up with a band that was playing live and sang Janis Joplin. And if you know Janis Joplin, singing Janis Joplin is no easy feat, but she got up there and conquered it. She's a dancer. She can do a mean beat, boot, scoot, and boogie. She likes her country line dancing, and she loves her Latin dancing. She, in her own mind, is fluent in Spanish. Of the group of us that go to Mexico together, I am probably the most fluent, and I'm far from fluent. But Anne has perfected Spanglish. And it's amazing to watch because people will sit and she's talking her Spanglish, and every five words I'll actually hear a Spanish word that I understand. And people will look at her and nod as though they're understanding her, and I'm like, this is just amazing. There's one particular place that we hang out every day. It's a hotel pool, and there's a waiter there who will listen to her, and he's just so intent. He's looking her in the eye and listening to every word that she says. And then when she's done talking in slow motion, he'll turn his head and look at me and go. And I'll need to try to translate what it is that Anne just was asking or saying. And I also go along to visit the family down in Mazatlan. And often Anne and I have some concern or question about the house that we need to ask them about. And I try to ahead of time get a little inkling of what we're gonna need to ask in Spanish. And Anne storms in and does her Spanglish thing. And they all nod and understand. And then every 5 seconds she'll go, how do you say this, Noya? Noya, how do you say this? And I'll have to quickly come up with the answer. But again, interesting that they do seem to understand her brand of Spanglish. She is humorous. there's this thing that she does when she's entertained herself. She slaps her knee. Her shoulders kind of shrug like while she's laughing. And she gets this look on her face like she's just told a funny. And she is funny, and you can tell when she's entertained herself. And then there have been times where we've been sitting around enjoying a nice quiet dinner, and then all of a sudden we'll hear this as Anne has become passionate about some issue and her hand gets slammed on the table as we engage in a serious conversation about work. Many of those traits that you get to see from her in her work life are the same traits that we get to see as friends of hers. She is generous, generous beyond belief. She often knows what we need before we're even able to ask for it. She would literally give us the shirt off of her back. She is passionate, she is an advocate, and she has strong convictions. There's this guy that walks up and down the main drag in Mazatlan. He looks to be in his 80s. He's got a tray of donuts that's probably the half the size of this table. And he's got worn out tennis shoes and worn out clothes, and he walks up and down that street every day selling his donuts. He probably covers 15 to 20 miles every day. Anne and I took notice of him in our adventures around Mazatlan, and Anne took it upon herself on one trip to bring a pair of tennis shoes for him so that he would have nice shoes to wear. And then we sought him out one day so that we could buy all of his donuts and that he would be able to go home and not have to spend the day walking around selling his donuts. That's the kind of person she is, whether professional or personally, and I'm so honored to know her. So honored to be able to speak today on behalf of the posse, and so honored to be able to say these things about her with you. She is a wonderful person, she's dedicated, she's a hard worker, she loves her family, she loves her friends. I look forward to seeing the impact that she has through this position with the Minnesota Supreme Court. Thank you.
Thank you, Noya. And we are joined next by former Hennepin County District Court Judge and current Chief Judge of the White Earth Tribal Court, the Honorable Robert A. Blaeser. Judge Blaeser was the first Native American to serve as a District Court Judge in the state of Minnesota, and he co-founded the Minnesota American Indian Bar Association. It is my great honor to introduce Judge Robert Blaeser.
Governor Dayton, Chairman Tibbetts and members of the White Earth Nation Tribal Council, Chief Justice Gilday, the Associate Justices of the Minnesota Supreme Court, Chief Judge Cleary, judges of the Court of Appeals, my district court colleagues, and my tribal court colleagues, other elected officials and judges, family and friends of Judge McKeig. Thank you for your presence and the witness of an important point in Minnesota history today. I've had the privilege of knowing Judge McKeig for the last 20 years. I first met her when I went to juvenile court in Hennepin County in 1996. I went to the specialty court for a one-year assignment and stayed for 6 years. My longer tenure was to work on the Indian child welfare cases, and Judge McKeig was a young assistant county attorney in the ICWA unit. I learned she was a Minnesota Chippewa tribal descendant from Federal Dam, Minnesota. And you need only talk with Judge McKeig for a few minutes to find out the fact that she's from Federal Dam, because she's very proud of that. When I found out she was a Native descendant and wanted someday to be a judge, I took an interest in helping her prepare for and pursue her goals. As one of the ICWA judges, she appeared in front of me pretty much every day and sometimes multiple times a day. I saw a young attorney who was earnest, well-prepared, and a very zealous advocate for her client. Now, if you know child protection, You know it is an emotional courtroom, and where at times we might have five attorneys on a case. When I first saw Judge McKeig, she had this incredible array of facial expressions by which you could follow her opponent's arguments. She's probably rolling her eyes right now. When cases were done, we would get together to discuss her courtroom presence. And for the first couple of years, I'm not sure if she considered me a mentor or a tormentor. But she would not be outworked by anyone, and she was an excellent writer. We began making presentations together at the National Indian Child Welfare Association Conference and others around the country. She was an excellent presenter, and I was often the straight guy to her humorous approach. If Judge McKeig ever decides not to be a jurist, she has a promising future as a stand-up comic. Judge McKeig became an excellent attorney who cared about her work and volunteered on every effort outside of the court to help us improve the court system. She went on to write a curriculum for the National Indian Child Welfare Association, and she trains throughout the country on the Indian Child Welfare Act. When Judge McKeig first became a district court judge, I called her to congratulate her and explain Hennepin County's new mentoring program. I said, as a new judge, I advise her that if you ever feel lost on something, you can take a break, call your mentor judge, and his or her staff are instructed to interrupt court so that he or she can answer your questions. So I said, the good news is you get a mentor, but the bad news is it's me. Judge McKeig quickly learned criminal and did an excellent job. As a young judge, she didn't say a lot in meetings, but listened. Not a bad idea for a new judge. Also, it is in keeping with Anishinaabe culture to let your elders be heard and listen and learn. When it came time for her to go to a specialty court, we talked about it. Her passion was for child protection, but all her history was there. She wisely decided to go to family court. She quickly adapted to family court, and as always, she would not be outworked. Once, soon after arriving in family court, Judge McKeig was so intent on a hearing, she forgot some toast in her chambers in a toaster oven. This resulted in the entire Family Justice Center being evacuated. My wife happened to be driving by and called me and asked why everyone was on the street in front of the Family Justice Center. I think Judge McKeig was more than a little surprised when I called her cell phone and asked her if she could please ensure me that she had nothing to do with the evacuation of the Family Justice Center. Chief Gilday, I might consider banning toaster ovens in the chambers, just a thought. When Judge McKeig was going to become presiding judge of family court, I remember there were some concerns about how she would be as a leader of judges. Now that she's been chief, I would say there was no one in family court who did not think she was an excellent chief. As always, she was looking for ways to improve the court. She started the Family Court Enhancement Project to better identify and deal with domestic violence in family court. This effort has won her national accolades for the model that was developed. It bears repeating that Judge McKeig has a wicked sense of humor and is not above a practical joke on her colleagues, like the time she showed up in the courthouse, dressed head to toe as Gene Simmons, the lead singer of Kiss. The halls of justice, I think, will be a little less quiet from now on. But I'm proud to say that your new justice is of the people, a hard worker, a very good writer, always thinks of how her decisions will affect the people we serve, and a good collaborator. She is certainly not afraid to stand her ground, and I think she will serve the people of Minnesota well. I'm compelled to read a poem that was written by my sister, Kimberly Blaeser, who currently serves as the poet laureate for the state of Wisconsin. She wrote the poem for my swearing in 1995. It has been read by many tribes with her permission for the swearing in of their tribal judges. It has been used for the last couple of years at the closing ceremony for the National Native Judges Association. And my friend Dave Rash, who was a tribal judge in Wisconsin, heard it read in the Great Hall in Washington, D.C. It's called In the Tradition of the Peacemakers. Put on robes like garments of peace. Wear them, heavy with history. Long they join you to earth and full to harbor beneath their folds all voices, all shapes and sizes of vision. Put on robes like feathers and wear them, a symbol of honor and duty. Wear wisdom and compassion. Wear justice like a rainbow, all colors, a promise. Fill your robes with traditions, a will to peace and not to power. Speak voices of centuries. House in your heart laws fragile with age. Tend with your love their roots still bearing. From your hands dispense dignity to each person. Hold this office like a medicine, like a ritual to heal, to bestow human rights. Now I hear your name spoken by the elders. Now you must go forward. Burn cedar. Prepare yourself. Paint your face like a warrior for justice. Put on robes. Enter the council and join a league of peace. Miigwech.
Thank you, Judge Blaeser. And now we will proceed with the administration of the oath. Justice McKeig has asked me to administer the oath. Her mother and daughter will hold the Bible, and her husband and children will assist with the robing. So please come up.
Yes, Chief.
All right. Okay, Tana. We're all assembled.
Tana, come here. Over here. Put
the Bible like this. Yeah, hold it. Okay. All right, raise your right hand and repeat after me, please. I, Ann Catherine McKeig.
Ann Catherine McKeig.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Minnesota.
And the Constitution of the State of Minnesota.
And that I will discharge faithfully.
And I will discharge faithfully.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of Associate Justice.
Of Associate Justice.
Minnesota Supreme Court.
Minnesota Supreme Court.
To the best of my judgment and ability.
To the best of my judgment and ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 94th Associate Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court, the Honorable Justice Anne Catherine McKeig.
Thank you. I guess I don't need them. May it please the court, Chief Justice Gilday, Justices of the Minnesota Supreme Court, Judges of the Court of Appeals, Judges of the Tribal Courts, my colleagues of the District Court, Governor Dayton, distinguished guests, family and friends from near, far, and Federal Dam. Thank you all for taking time out of your busy lives to celebrate with myself and my family this historical occasion. There is not enough time for me to thank all of you, but I do thank all of you. You have all helped me in one way or another, and although I may forget to say thank you on occasion, I am grateful. I want to thank and acknowledge retired Associate Justice Christopher Dietzen for his many years of public service. Minnesota was lucky to have him as a member of the court, and he has earned his retirement. Miigwech to Governor Pawlenty for appointing me to the 4th Judicial District in 2008. It was an honor and an education to serve with my colleagues in the 4th. The job of a district court judge, whether tribal or state, is difficult and challenging, one that often rewards good work with more work. But it is an important one, and it is the workhorse of our judicial system, and I am grateful for having been a part of it. And I have to mention the law clerks. Brittany, Maggie, Laura, Katie, Tawny, Topanga, also known as Topanga, and the many others, and I'm just blanking on names. Without you, I wouldn't be where I am. Your hard work, loyalty, dedication, and brilliant minds help all of us do our job on a daily basis. To Governor Dayton, Chimigwich, for having faith in a young woman from Federal Dam, born, raised, and Minnesota educated. You have made history in allowing me to be the first Native American woman appointed to the state's highest court in all of the United States. I am prepared with the love and support of my community to demonstrate that your decision was one of great vision and wisdom, not because you chose me, but because you appreciate the role that Native nations have played in the history of our great state. By this appointment, you have built a historic bridge. To Mike Freeman, for giving me a job and a chance to work on one of the most important areas of law, child protection. For there truly is no greater resource to all of our futures than our children. And now to my family,
a couple of complaints. I've been waiting for this moment. To my brothers, Mike, you're the oldest and perhaps the wisest, but you're not funny. Give it up. To my brother, Pat, who did not deserve a B in high school French class. He only got a B because he attended the teacher's Miss Minnesota pageant. It's true, Mom. And Casey, while I appreciate the fact that you allowed me to dress you up as my sister, it does not change the fact that you were a giant pain growing up. And John, where are you? There you are. You're the lucky one because you remind all of us of Dad. And you should be extremely proud of that. Mom, you done good. You raised us right. None of us have been arrested. And we all pay our taxes. My grandmother, who is kind of annoyed with me because she hasn't made any of the media, so please make sure somebody puts this in a paper or on the news. Ann Waddles of Bemidji, who is 96, turning 97 in November, still in her home, who couldn't make it here today, but who would have made it here today had it been at a casino. So for her, my Aunt Val, and my Uncle Phil, who has complained incessantly that the non-native side of the family has not gotten enough attention, Nasrovia. I don't really know what it means. It's a Polish word. I don't think it's a swear word. I think it means something about your health. And now that Noya has talked about my fabulous Spanish, a mis amigos de habla España y familia aquí y en México, gracias por todo. Su amor y apoyo es muy importante. Muy importante para mí. Shh. Me ha permitido ser parte de su vida y me ha hecho una mejor persona a causa de él. To my husband Jose, my comadre Lulis, and my five beautiful, smart, kind, and expensive children, Balam, Siko, Itzel, Caleb, and Tiana. You are why it all matters. Everything I do is for you, and I love you more than words can say. My dad, Monty McKeig, died in 1994 at the young age of 61. From a long battle with diabetes. He was the strong, silent type. He could give you a look and you knew what it meant. He commanded respect simply by his presence in a room. He was and is my hero, and I never wanted to disappoint him. In 1996, I met another Indian man who reminded me of him, Robert A. Blaeser, the longest serving Native American district court judge who was sworn into office in 1995. He came to juvenile court in 1996, and I was an assistant Hennepin County attorney, and somehow I found myself to be his mentee. And I am not sure how it happened, but it did seem to happen naturally. There was a court hearing, and I think Swanee's here, right there. And we were all in court, and Judge Blaeser looked up and remarked, "Look at this courtroom. It is all Native people looking out for what's best for this child. Just look around and take it in." It was a profound moment. Judge Blaeser has never let me down. He has stood by my side through the good and the burning of toast. He has had faith in me, even when I didn't possess it in myself. Judge Blaeser, you have led so that I may follow. I know that you are tired. You have passed the torch, and I shall do my best to keep it lit. Those of you who know me know my passion for the welfare of children. Nelson Mandela once said, "There can be no keener revelation of a society's soul than the way in which it treats its children." Governor Dayton has recognized the great need for change in our child protection system by implementing the Child Protection Task Force, and change has begun as a result of that task force, but much needs to be done. We cannot leave this important issue to those of a few dedicated individuals. We as a community have an obligation to work on behalf of all children, for it truly takes a village to raise a child. I urge all of you to become involved in some way to better the lives of the forgotten children. They are our future, and we have an obligation to do our very best for them. The role that I am taking on as an Associate Justice of the Minnesota Supreme Court is an important one with serious responsibilities. This I understand, and I will do my very best to serve all Minnesotans. I also promise to never take myself too seriously, nor forget who I am or where I came from. I leave with you the following from the Native Code of Ethics, which I hope to live by: to serve others, to be of some use to family, community, nation, and the world, is one of the main purposes for which human beings have been created. Do not fill yourself with your own affairs and forget your most important talks. True happiness comes only to those who dedicate their lives to the service of others. Thank you all so much for coming today.
Well said, Justice McKeig, and congratulations again. And now, please, audience, be seated. The White Earth Tribal Council has a special presentation to make, so I'm going to ask them to come forward. I can't see you. There they come. Excellent. Thank you. Please come forward.
I'd like to say thank you, special thank you to the governor of Minnesota here for appointing one of our strong women to the court system here. You know, it's a great honor and a privilege to be here. That being said, you know, I'd like to just take a minute to honor Ann McKeig and her appointment. It's a big step for us here in Indian Country. On behalf of the White Earth Tribal Council, the White Earth Nation, we say McGwich to the governor for supporting that and being here for us. I'd also like to say thank you to our honor guard for bringing in these colors. Our Eagle Staffs, flag of the U.S., flag of the Minnesota, our white earth nation. With those, I'd like to say thank you to everybody for being here and spending time with us. We do have a special presentation for Ann. Don't take a moment. We do this in honor of our people that reached the pinnacle of their careers. So with this, we'd like to say thank you to Ann. This is a Pendleton blanket, and in our fashion of the Native American people, we're going to wrap her up in it. Also, with great honor and privilege, we'd like to give Ann the White Earth State flag to hang in her office. Also, we have some of White Earth's finest. Wild rice.
Thank you.
You're good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What a day in history. Native American in the Supreme Court. As a boy growing up in Indian country, I've been in front of a few judges before, but man, look at over here. On a federal dam, I hate to burst your bubble, but she's a white earth descendant. Chief McWitch.
On behalf of the judges and staff of the Minnesota Judicial Branch, I want to thank St. Catharines and President Roloff for letting us be here today in this beautiful facility, and I want to thank all of our speakers and participants this afternoon for making this such a very, very special event. And thank you to all of you for attending and for sharing in this historic occasion. I'll call now on the Supreme Court Commissioner to adjourn us. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Chief. Please stand as the judges and our special guests recess, and then please join everyone for the reception in the auditorium.
You